I am an archaeologist, and archaeologists do not study dinosaurs. We study people through the analysis of their remains. And by remains, I don't just mean skeletal materials, but all of the stuff we leave behind. Even prehistoric K-cups, I guess. So we call these artifacts, and it's anything that people have made or modified or moved. Now, most of the time, we end up studying garbage. It's all the debris from everyday living. Once in a while, we'll come across something special, like these pot-bellied owl pendants from Poverty Point that are made, carved out of red jasper stone. For archaeologists, it's not just about the artifacts, though. It's really about their relationships to each other and to other things. So it's about association and context. So when somebody brings us a shoebox full of artifacts or a cigar box that they collected years ago from places they don't really remember, we can't tell them very much about them. We really need to know where they came from on the landscape, what the patterns were, what other things they were found with. And so that's really how we learn about the people who made these kinds of artifacts. I got into archaeology because it's a really cool combination of history and science and dirt. I mean, who doesn't love dirt? And really, it's the study of our past, of humanity's past. It tells the story of how we came to be the way we are. So when you think about it, our ancestors have been living on this earth for many, many years, and they've confronted a lot of the same issues that we face today. Droughts, floods, access to resources, habitat destruction, climate change. And so why would we not want to learn from those experiences? I'm fortunate to be the archaeologist at Poverty Point. It's really a cool job. For those of you who don't know, Poverty Point is an archaeological site. It's also a Louisiana State Historic Site. It's a National Historic Landmark. It's a national monument, and it's a UNESCO World Heritage Site. So it's really a big deal, not just to archaeologists, but to a lot of people. Archaeologists have been working at Poverty Point for on and off for more than 100 years, since 1913. And we've built up a pretty good knowledge base about the site. And in fact, it was that knowledge that allowed me and my colleagues to develop a good case for Poverty Point's outstanding universal value to humanity. And that was a big part of getting the site onto the World Heritage List. In a nutshell, Poverty Point is a monumental earthwork site. The original configuration consisted of five earthen mounds, A, B, C, E, and F. A sixth mound, Mound D, was added much later, around AD 700, by a different culture. Poverty Point, the construction and occupation of the site, I should have mentioned, dates back to about 1700 to 1100 BC. So it's built by American Indians. In addition to the mounds, we have the concentric earthen ridges. There are six nested ridges. This was the habitation area for the site. This is where we find most of the artifacts. This is where we find the hearths and the earth ovens and post holes that are probably associated with house structures. Just to give you a sense of the scale, from north to south, the outermost diameter is about 3/4 of a mile. In the last part, to mention is the interior plaza. It's large, it's flat, it's part of the created landscape. And there is evidence for large circles of posts within the southern part of the plaza, about 30 of them. We don't quite have that figured out, what they were doing with those. All in all, to prepare the landscape and to build the mounds required about 100 million 50-pound basket loads of dirt. That's a lot of dirt to move by hand. When people come to see Poverty Point, one of the things they find most remarkable is Mound A. It's really a mini mountain. It's the second largest earthen mound in North America, and is about 15.5 million basket loads of dirt. Sorry. One of the other really interesting things about Poverty Point is that there is no naturally occurring stone at the site. So for a culture that relied upon stone for making their tools and ornaments and other implements, they had to bring in stone. The nearest sources of gravel are 25 to 30 miles away, but they brought stone in from distances up to 800 miles. And about an estimated 78 US tons of stone were brought to the site. The other kind of really fascinating thing about Poverty Point is that it was constructed by hunter-gatherers. Archaeologists didn't know that people who lived by fishing and hunting and gathering had the capabilities to produce such a monumental achievement. And so it really made us rethink what we thought we knew about humanity and about our past. Poverty Point isn't the oldest monumental earthwork, and it's not the largest, but it really stands out. There were no sites, monumental sites, that could match the size of Poverty Point prior to construction of the site, and it was another 2,000 years after Poverty Point before it was exceeded in size. The design is completely unique in the world. Archaeologists like to think of Poverty Point as the New York City of its day. It was so huge and so sophisticated and so different from everything else that was going on at that time. It really gives us a different picture of humanity. Because context is so important for archaeologists, we're incredibly deliberate, or we try to be, in our excavations and our field research. We take measurements, we take photographs, we draw maps, we take extensive notes, because we realize that as we're excavating, we are destroying that site. So when we go back to the lab and we start to work on our analyses, we can't go back and redig if we're not sure about something. For that reason, the archaeological record is considered a non-renewable resource. And that also is why archaeologists today no longer excavate an entire site. We realize that the archaeological techniques and methods change over time, and there are changes in the analytic sophistication and our abilities. So we want to preserve parts of that site so that future archaeologists can come back and gain an even deeper understanding of the site. So as an example, in 1955, James Ford, an archaeologist, and his colleagues decided to excavate in Mound B, which is one of the mounds at the site. So he attached a blade to a tractor, and they essentially scraped several trenches through the mound. The idea was that to expose a side view so they could see all the different layers of construction. And they, in essence, destroyed about half the mound in that process. Now, we wouldn't let that happen today, but back in the 50s, that was sometimes acceptable. Now, one of the things that he found, in addition to understanding, improving his understanding of the construction of the site, was he was able to get material for radiocarbon dating so he could understand when the site had been built. Radiocarbon dating was really in its infancy at that time. And so this is how much charcoal was required for a single radiocarbon date during Fort's time. About nearly 50 years later, archaeologists T.R. Kidder and Tony Ortman came back to Mound B, and they pulled some 2-inch diameter soil cores from undisturbed parts of the mound. So they were able to confirm and actually enhance Ford's understanding of the construction sequence of the mound, just based on their analyses from those cores. And also they got material for a radiocarbon date, and this is how much they needed. When you look at the dates that they produced, so the top 5 dates are from Ford's work back in the 1950s, and the bottom date is from Kidder and Ortman's work. What's important is you'll notice here, this is the date as recorded in radiocarbon years, and the plus or minus for the error term is much larger for those older dates than for Kidder and Ortman's dates. And once those dates in radiocarbon years are translated into calendar years, you can see that the spreads are much, much larger. And in fact, a lot of Ford's dates extend beyond the accepted age of Poverty Point, whereas this one fits in there very nicely. So there's been a huge change in the technology just of radiocarbon dating. In 2011, I discovered a previously unknown mound at the site. And in 2013 and 2014, I collaborated with soil scientists Thurman Allen and archaeologist Renita Dalen to investigate this mound. And the first thing we did was to just pull some soil cores to establish that for sure it was a mound and that it wasn't just a natural bump on the landscape. And then we took a series, a couple of transects of smaller cores across the mound so that we could trace the stratigraphy. We could trace the layers across the mound so we could get an understanding of the construction history. And then we brought out some geophysical instruments that would allow us to map what was going on underground. In essence, we created maps that showed different soil properties that allowed us to understand how the mound was built and what kinds of soils had been used. And then finally, I excavated a single 1 meter by 1 meter unit. And this gives a better view of the stratigraphy than you can get from a single core or a couple of cores. And it also allowed me to take soil samples and get samples of the artifacts that were in the mound. I also got radio material for radiocarbon dates that were, of course, comparable in size to what Kidder and Ortman used. And I was also able to take some soil samples from the soil directly beneath the mound that we could use for luminescence dating. And luminescence dating allows you to establish the last time sunlight shone on that dirt. So it's a more direct reflection of when that mound was built and when the sunlight was cut off. So now we can answer a lot of the same questions that Ford tried to answer with much less impact to the mound, and in some cases with more precision and more detail. So there is a big change in technology that's affected archaeology. The same is true for artifacts. In our curatorial facility at Poverty Point, we have artifacts from most of the field projects that have been conducted at the site. We have hundreds of thousands, probably more than 1 million once we get the final tally on those. And those are available for research by archaeologists, and we have about 2,000 that are in the on-site museum for visitors to see. But those artifacts that are available for researchers, you know, we can apply new technologies, and so we're learning new things from these already collected artifacts. Since we've become a World Heritage Site, a couple of the issue or the potential conflict between conservation and research has come up. So some people have suggested, well, now maybe you should just focus on preserving the site and not doing any more research since it's destructive. And other people have said, maybe you should have continuous, ongoing excavation so that visitors can come to the site and they can observe and maybe even participate in the research process. So those seem like two different extremes. And I would like to make the case that somewhere in the middle is probably more appropriate. We don't want to discontinue all field research because you'll be more successful managing a deposit or a resource that you understand. So as we do more research, we get a better understanding of the deposits, and that will help us with management. At the same time, doing continuous excavation just to please visitors is probably, I would say, in conflict with our conservation ethic. So I'm working on a research design that identifies what the big gaps in our knowledge are, that sets out research questions and prioritizes those questions and lays out plans for how to go about answering those questions. And what we want to do is to continue to get knowledge to better our understanding of the site, at the same time trying to be conservative. So we will try to glean as much information as we can from previous excavations, from existing collections, and only impact the site as much as we have to in order to answer the research questions. I guess I would like to conclude by saying that, you know, it's the deep past of Poverty Point and other archaeological sites that inspires us and makes us think about what it means to be human. But it's the potential scientific breakthroughs and our obligation to protect the legacy of the past that motivates us to ensure Poverty Point's survival for future generations.